Good morning. Welcome to our worship on the sixth Sunday of Easter. The Lord is with you. Amen. Welcome all guests that are here, a special day of confirmation. As a vacancy pastor, one of the tasks set before me is to keep the momentum going in the church when the pastor leaves. The tendency for things to slow down, and COVID was an issue with that, but there's, if you look through the bulletin, there's a lot of things that are going on in the church. Of course, besides all those things, just planning for the new pastor that's coming soon. So just many exciting things regarding the church that are going on. And when it comes to the new pastor, I think there were only 55 from the seminary that were available for calls, and so you got one. And again, I'm very happy for you and for, you know, the hope that's set before you in these next months. I do have a few announcements to share. There's a letter from Pastor Levenhagen that's printed inside the pastor that's going to be coming, I think, sometime in July. There's also a flower pickup. There's a basket pickup. Be noted, the voters' meeting is next Sunday on the 12th in the all-purpose room. 7 o'clock Ascension Day service here in the sanctuary, and please do come for that. Were there any other announcements? Okay, well, if not, would you please rise for the processional hymn? Don't you two want to be next to each other?
Oh.
the invocation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just,
will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Would you please kneel as you're able? Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight
in your will
and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
O God, the giver of all that is good, by your holy inspiration, grant that we may think those things that are right, and by your merciful guiding, accomplish them through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. The scripture readings.
Reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 10. Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly, I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee, after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and made him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." While Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed, because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. For they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, "Can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked him to remain for some days. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be
to God.
The epistle reading is from 1 John chapter 5. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by the water only, but by the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please rise for the Alleluia verse. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 15th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lays down his life for his friends. And you are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and appointed you, that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, that you love one another. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Would you join with me in the Nicene Creed? I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ,
the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, light, light of light, very God,
very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made,
who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man,
and was crucified.
He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, and ascended into heaven,
and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead,
whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Would you please be seated? The hymn.
Thank you.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord God, Heavenly Father, I pray that you would bless this time of meditation, a precious passage of Scripture that is in there to speak to our hearts in the way that we should live now. And I pray that you would even work through me by your Spirit to speak to the hearts of these, your people, on the way that they should live, the way that they should go, and even change in their lives from the ways of the culture, the way of family. In your mercy, hear and bless, and may you again speak precious words of your truth to these, your servants. In Jesus' name, amen. The Lord is with you. Amen. As many of you know, the First World War was fought primarily in trenches in Europe. And there were the Americans, the French, the British, they were on one side and they were in trenches. And then there was like a no man's land. There were barbed wire and there were booby traps. And on the other side were the German fortifications. And there was one wintry day that the German soldiers put up a sign. And this is the sign that they wanted the other group of soldiers to see. Oops. Anybody know German a little bit? Yeah, God mit uns. God is with us. And this is something that the German soldiers were convinced of, that God was on their side, and so they were the superior force. But soon afterwards, the Americans put up their sign. And this is what they said. We got men's too. It was a classic case of a failure to communicate, but it also highlights the way it is with us people, us in this world, when it comes to setting up distinctions between ourselves and other people. And it starts very early on when we're kids. You know, I'm better than you are, the king of the mountain kind of an attitude. First grade, the boys are prancing around, boys are better than girls, that kind of thing. And then, when kids get older, you know, it's, and for Jonathan, Samantha, it's, there's the cool, and then there's the uncool kind of thing, those distinctions there. And when you get older, there's the distinctions between those who are more affluent, those who don't have as much, those who are more educated, those are the dropouts. And it also carries over to the area of religion, that there are those who would feel superior and try to exclude others who they feel are inferior. And it took 150 years for the Southern Baptists to admit and to confess that they were wrong because they were supporting slavery. And it was in 2008 that Bob Jones University finally admitted their error in not admitting black students before 1971. So again, those differentiations. And when it came to biblical times, they were huge. And the big one was the Jew and the Gentile, the Jew and the non-Jew. And this is really the elephant in the room when it comes to today's lesson from the book of Acts. And the Jewish people were not allowed to mingle at all with the Gentiles. They were not allowed to speak to them, to go to their homes, to eat their food, to even help them, you know, when somebody was sick. Not allowed to do that. There was no measure of getting along between the two groups. But then Jesus the Jew came along. And maybe you remember that from John chapter 4, there was a Samaritan woman at the well, and Jesus spoke to her. It shocked her that Jesus was willing to do that, and afterwards he spent time with his disciples, with people in the Samaritan town. And then there was the woman who was whose daughter was demon-possessed, and Jesus cast out that evil spirit. And so there was a sensing among the disciples that change was coming, and there was this tension, and Peter was feeling the tension. You know, his culture told him that it was important to keep away from the Gentiles, but Jesus was saying, build bridges to those who are the Gentiles. So Peter had to make a decision, and it was something that needed to be forced, because God was going to do something amazing and break down walls, but it was, again, necessary for Peter to experience its change when it came to these understandings. And it was difficult. For instance, if Peter would be in contact with the corpse of an insect, he would have to wash his clothes, wash himself totally, and he would be unclean, you know, until evening. I mean, it was that way. And in today's lesson, well, prior to the lesson, in fact, Peter is hungry, he ends up in being in a trance, and then all of a sudden, there's this blanket that comes down with a lot of unkosher, unclean, forbidden food, animals. And there was the word spoken, arise, Peter, kill and eat. And Peter reminds God of his rules, Lord, I've never eaten of anything that's unclean or impure. And then the angel says, do not count anything that God calls to be pure, impure. And this was repeated twice, so that Peter would really get the lesson concerning this when it came to the eating of foods. And for us who enjoy ham and scallops and lobster, it's kind of hard to comprehend these differentiations that were taking place back then. And it would almost be like today, you know, the Southern Baptists speak out more about against drinking alcoholic beverages. But again, just pretend that they've got a convention, and then all of a sudden there's this fully loaded bar that comes down into their midst, you know, and there's a voice saying, drink up. And they would say, no, Lord, we're Baptist. That kind of an understanding. So you can imagine that Peter was shaken by what had taken place. It was really troubling him, and just he's trying to process this, you could, like this pigs in the blanket experience that he was, that had just taken place. And then there's this second jolt that takes place, that there's these men who are Gentiles who are knocking on the door of where he's staying, and at the same time the Spirit tells him, I have sent these men to you, go with them and do not have any doubts about what's going to take place. I mean, they were strong words. So you really get the impression that God is serious about this whole matter. And so Peter ends up going to the home of the centurion, whose name is Cornelius, and again, Jews were not supposed to even enter in the home of a man, a Gentile, and then this is a Roman centurion, so what's Peter thinking? He's a Gentile, but he's also a bad guy. He eats ham, and this man's wearing a toga, and Peter's got his yarmulke, you know, and he's got his beard. So again, unclean, uncircumcised, unkosher, those were Peter's first impressions of what was taking place. But looking a little bit more deeply, you recognize that this man Cornelius was pious. He helped people who were in need, but he was also a man of prayer. And then Cornelius mentions to Peter that he was praying, and that the angel told him to go send men to find Peter and tells him it was 30 miles away exactly where Peter is at. And so Peter's, again, shocked, and he's thinking through all of this. He's thinking about, again, the blanket coming down and then the repetition of all of that. And finally, it's time for the seismic shift of understanding. And in the lesson, it says Peter opened his mouth, but it's really speaking about an utterance that's momentous. And he says, you know that we Jews do not associate with other people, but God has told me that he thinks that there is no one who is unclean, that no one is unfit. Again, and this was huge. This was huge, and it was God working through layer upon layer of these ethnic rules of the Jewish people, and causing Peter to recognize that the salvation, the redemption of Jesus was available for all people. And you remember maybe Tevye and Fiddler in the Roof, tradition, 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 but not so anymore. No more are there to be those differentiations between people regarding ethnicity, when it came to status in society, when it came to possessions. No more of that. That was supposed to be the new way. So again, this huge understanding of Peter. And in our lesson, you hear him. He preaches to those people that are there. And in our lesson, it's just the basics of the faith, about Jesus coming into the world, his life, death, and resurrection, you know, a forgiveness of sins and everlasting life. So he's going through all that, but before he can even have an altar call, the Holy Spirit comes down on these people, and they speak in tongues, and they glorify God. And it's like a second Pentecost that's taken place. And those Jewish men who are with Peter are shocked at all of this taking place. And what's going on is that that when it comes now to these understandings that they had, and we would call it discrimination, segregation, prejudice, bias, whatever you want to call it, there's no more of that. There's to be no more. And the basic understanding was that God is not a racist. That was to be the major understanding. So having you heard, hearing all of this, what does this say for us here today in this church on the way that we should live? And I spoke a little bit earlier about the situation in our youth when it came to those differentiations that we're all familiar with, that the cool and the uncool, and you know, those who have money and those who don't, and the pecking order. It's very easy to have that kind of thing. And you know, that's something that's so much a part of our lives. And have you ever considered this and the effect that it has on you and your life? And have you come to grips with it just to be able to deal with it and understand it, and that there's some of that that's probably hung on with you when it comes to these differentiations? And what do I mean by that? Like, growing up, were you ever told that there were certain people that you were not supposed to associate with? I was told. And for those of you who are here, if a relative or a loved one were asked, are you open-minded or closed-minded, what would their response be regarding you being open-minded or closed-minded? And in your life, have you recognized that there are some barriers that have been erected when it comes to race, when it comes to religion, when it comes to social issues, when it comes to economics? Have you sensed any of that in your life. And it's so easy again to have these understandings. John, he's an alcoholic. Why doesn't he just stop drinking? Or Jane, she's divorced, or she's been on drugs, has got some strikes against her. Or Bill, you know, he's to the far left when it comes to his politics. Or Jim is to the far right. You know, those understandings. And when it came to the world of Peter, there was so much of that. And you could say, frankly, that Peter was a racist. You just sense that with the Jewish people. Even going back to the prophet Jonah, especially if you know that story, that very much of a racist, but those racist understandings. And what was God trying to tell Peter? And what is he trying to tell us? Basically, get off your high horse. That's what he's saying. Get off your high horse. And thinking about the whole issue of racism, maybe you've heard it as of late that America is a racist nation. Have you heard that lately? Heard that? I've heard a lot. But frankly, when I hear that, I say to myself, what nation is not a racist nation? Which one? Every nation has these differentiations between when it comes to superior and inferior. I mean, it's just a fact of life. But it's not just when it comes to nations, it's also for ourselves. And I was reminded of this maybe about 3 years ago. I was in Emmanuel Lutheran Church and we were in Bible class. And, I just mentioned to the classes I've been thinking this thing through that we live in Des Plaines, Illinois, near the airport. And over the years, we've been there now for 11 years, I've noticed that there are more people of color that are in the area. And so it has come to my mind, this thought. Well, what about if it really changes? And the property values go down. What if it's no longer going to be an Anglo community? I've thought that way, and frankly, that's racist thinking on my part. It really is. But I've also come to understand that when it comes to me, but also for all of us here, that we all have that fallen human nature within us. And it's more prevalent when we're kids, but it's that fallen human nature, the more the dark side, but setting up those differentiations that in life, we can be very prone, all of us, to this. And frankly, it is only God's Holy Spirit in our lives that gives us a balance, because otherwise it's so easy to be caught up with that and to go the wrong way. And just to go more deeper into the dark side of understandings concerning all of this. So what is this lesson saying to us who are here in this church? I believe it's for us to consider what are some of the things that keep us distanced from other people who are different than we are. And also to believe, as we would even be willing to take baby steps in this area, to trust that God would bless and make fruitful our ministry of this church. Really believe that. And again, it's this willingness to get off the high horse. And there's a movie that came out some years ago that really spoke to me concerning that. It was called Gran Torino. Clint Eastwood was in the movie. Maybe you saw Gran Torino, some of you. And Clint plays this fellow's name is Walt Kowalski. He's retired, he's in Detroit, and he's in a rundown neighborhood. He's trying to keep up his house, but things are starting to fall apart around him. He's a Korean War veteran, and he speaks about people from Southeast Asia's gooks. You know, he's an Archie Bunker type of guy. And then there's these people that are Hmong from Southeast Asia that move in, you know, and he despises these people. But as circumstances continue, this man starts to realize that he has more in common with them than his family that's out in the suburbs. And he develops a friendship, a relationship with them. So he becomes like family to them. And in the end of the movie, he becomes a Christ figure. He's willing to die for them. Just like Jesus, when we were alienated from God, that Jesus, again, came to bring us again to that relationship with the Father. So, this whole issue, which is, I believe, extremely significant for us and for our culture. And Jonathan, Samantha, I've been thinking about the two of you as of late when it comes to this. And when it comes to the future and the way that you look at people, and isn't it so easy, again, to group people together, you know, in the wrong way? And where I think it's so prevalent, many of you recognize that as of late, is at the college campuses. Just the racism that's arisen. I mean, and these are youth that are only 4, 5, 6 years older than you are that are dealing with this, and you would think that they would know better, but they're grouping Jewish people, and no doubt there's a lot of good Jewish kids, but they've grouped them all together with and hate speech. It's just a terrible thing. And so may God, by his Spirit, give you balance in your coming days. Through his word, through the fellowship of the saints, and so much has to do with the influences that will be coming forth in your life. And I think all of us know here that when it comes to the media, that they are big influencers. And the media is really good in developing this us versus them mentality. So may it be that God, by his grace, give you that balance. And be able to see people and to look beyond some of those stereotypes and to know that blessing of relationship with others who are different, again, that the walls would keep tumbling down. In Jesus' name, amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts, keep your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. At this time, we continue with the order of confirmation, and I would ask that Jonathan Luke Habercost and Samantha Rose Barnett would come forward, and also the family members, if they would want to come forward too, please. Beloved in the Lord, our Lord Jesus Christ said to his apostles, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." You have been baptized and catechized in the Christian faith according to our Lord's bidding. Jesus said, "Whoever confesses me before men, I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father in heaven. So lift up your hearts, therefore, to the God of all grace, and joyfully give answer to what I now ask you in the name of our Lord. Do you this day, in the presence of God and of this congregation, acknowledge the gifts that God gave you in your baptism? Then answer, yes, I do. Do you renounce the devil? Then answer, yes, I renounce him. Do you renounce all his works? Then answer, yes, I renounce them. Do you renounce all his ways? Then answer, yes, I renounce them. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth? And answer, I do so believe. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried? He descended into hell, and the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you so believe? Then answer, I do. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting? Then answer, I do. Do you hold to all the prophetic and apostolic scriptures to be the inspired word of God? Then answer, I do. Do you confess the doctrine of the Lutheran Church, drawn from the scriptures, as you've learned to know it from the small catechism, to be faithful and true? Then answer, yes, I do. And do you intend to hear the word of God and receive the Lord's Supper faithfully? Then answer, I do, by the grace of God. And do you intend to live according to the word of God and in faith, word and deed, to remain true to God, faith, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, even to death? Then answer, I do, by the grace of God. Do you intend to continue steadfast in the confession of the church and to suffer all, even death, rather than fall away from it? Then answer, I do, by the grace of God. We rejoice with thankful hearts that you have been baptized and have received the teachings of the Lord. You have confessed the faith and been absolved of your sins. As you continue to hear the Lord's word and receive his blessed sacrament, he who has begun a good work in you will bring it to completion in the day of Jesus Christ. And Samantha, would you bow, please? Samantha Rose Barnett, the Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you a new birth of water and the Spirit, and has forgiven you all of your sins, strengthen you with his grace to life that is everlasting. Amen, amen, and amen.
Samantha, the verse you've chosen is Matthew 28, verse 20. Behold, I am with you always to the end of the age.
Amen. You may rise. And Jonathan Luke Habercost. The Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and the Holy Spirit, and has forgiven you all of your sins, strengthen you with his grace to life that is everlasting. Amen.
John, the verse you have chosen is Matthew 28, verse 19. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the
Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may rise. We pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you that for your great goodness in bringing these, your sons and daughters, to the knowledge of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and enabling them both with a heart to believe and with a mouth to confess his saving name. Grant that, bringing forth the fruits of faith, they may continue steadfast and victorious to the day when all have fought the good fight of faith and shall receive the crown of righteousness through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. Peace be with you. You may go back to your seats. Amen. We continue now with the next hymn. Before the sharing of peace, would you rise first for the prayers of the church. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs.
Heavenly Father, you invite us freely to come and hear your word. Bless and increase our faith, that we may rightly fear you and learn what you have done for our souls.
Lord, in your mercy.
Lord Jesus, we give you our thanks and praise for your continued blessings on our congregation. You have heard and answered our prayers by sending Pastor Levin Hagen to serve among us. Please be with him as he finishes his coursework at the seminary, and bless him as he will soon graduate. Be with him, his wife Jill, and their children, Nathan and Faith, as they prepare to move to our community. May this time for them be filled with excitement and joy. Give each one of them your peace in this transition and strength to trust in you as you direct their lives.
Lord, in your mercy.
Lord God, the giver of all that is good, grant your healing and support to all who are in sick, especially Vivian Durenberger, John Onken, Tim Childers, and Margaret Zagel. Give them a speedy recovery and good health quickly.
Lord, in your mercy.
Heavenly Father, whose Son, Jesus Christ, loved the young and called them to himself, we ask you to bless Samantha Barnett and Jonathan Haberkost on their confirmation day. Strengthen them in the faith through the sacrament of Christ's body and blood, so that they may grow spiritually and bring forth the fruits of faith in a life of love toward others, to the praise and honor of your holy name.
Lord, in your mercy.
Merciful God, at the death of your Son, you gave the testimony of your Spirit in the water and blood that poured from his wounded side. Grant that having received this testimony in the water of baptism, we may also receive it in the body and blood of Jesus, in the Holy Supper, and so overcome the world by our faith in him.
Lord, in your mercy. Lord, in our special petitions, we remember Carrie Wisnant regarding physical weakness, and also Dale Woke, who's recovering from a surgical procedure. We also pray for Nathan Steele, for Marilyn Mueller, for Jim Breon and his son who were in a terrible car accident. May there be further healing. Also for Mara Mashinsky regarding the healing process in her life. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we ask that you would give great wisdom and discretion to our nation's leaders regarding the tinderbox of what's taking place in the Middle East and in the Ukraine. So much in the way of tensions. Give them wisdom that there can be a working through of circumstances rather than things getting way out of hand. Grant them special wisdom. Lord, in your mercy. We pray, Lord, that you would grant wisdom, discretion to leaders of the college campuses and the cities when it comes to the rioting on the streets, and then as our nation as a whole working through this whole issue of racism in the right way, that this could even be used ultimately for a blessing and a purging and coming to grips with this major issue. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, regarding the border crisis, grant wisdom, discretion. We pray that you would keep safe those who are guarding the border, and that there would be working through regarding policies where our security would not be in jeopardy in this land. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, Heavenly Father, we gratefully remember the sufferings and death of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, for our salvation. Rejoicing in his victorious resurrection from the dead, we draw strength from his ascension before you, who ever stands for us as our own high priest. Gather us together from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. For to you alone we give glory, honor, and worship, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. At this time, would you take the opportunity to greet each other, please?
Good morning, God's peace.
We continue now with the order of Holy Communion. Would you please rise as you're able? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God. And most especially are we bound to praise you on this day for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb, who was sacrificed for us and bore the sins of the world. And by his dying, he has destroyed death. And by his rising again, he has restored to us everlasting life. And therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. And after the same manner, he took the cup when he had supped. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it. This cup is new testament of my blood, which is shed for you for the remission of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Amen.
salvation from day to day. Sing to the Lord, bless God's name. Tell of God's salvation from day to day.
Sing to the Lord a new song. Oh, sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Declare God's glory among the nations.
Would you please rise as you're able? The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ to strengthen and preserve you, in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Just with a salutary gift, we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us with the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you.
join with me in the Easter acclamation? He's risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah.